Hello, young scholars. This is Mr. Martiron with your flipped classroom, and in this video, we're going to take a look at absolutism, enlightenment, and the age of revolutions. All right, young scholars, so one of the first absolute monarchs we need to talk about is Philip II of Spain. Philip is important because he is the first absolute monarch that we're going to talk about that governs by the idea of divine right. And remember, divine right is the idea that the monarch's power comes from God. So Philip II had absolute power and absolute control, meaning that he wielded ultimate control over the government and its people. And he had the authority to lead an inquisition or to hold trials for people that were accused of false Catholic beliefs. He removed many Protestants, Jews, and Muslims from Spain, and he ultimately tried to invade England with the Spanish Armada, but was defeated by Queen Elizabeth. The defeat of the Spanish Armada marked the end of Spain's dominance over the Atlantic Ocean and will now give rise to England. Now we're going to jump across the English Channel and we're going to take a look at the reign of James I. And James I really wasn't that great of a leader. James I was the first Stuart King of England, and he tried to exert the power of the crown over Parliament. And remember the Magna Carta. The Magna Carta says that no one, not even the king, is above the law. Well, James I writes his book, The True Law of a Free Monarchy, and he argues with Parliament over everything. And things in England got so bad that many fled out of fear of religious persecution. And out of some of these groups, they come to America and form the colony of Jamestown. James's son, Charles I, ruled next, and Charles was toxic. He had a strong distaste for Parliament. So a couple things to keep in mind. Charles was Catholic, and Parliament was Protestant. So not only do you have a power struggle dynamic that's happening, you also have a religious power struggle dynamic that's happening. So Charles tries to govern as an absolute monarch, he imprisons his foes, and ultimately, he tries to raise taxes without Parliament's consent. And in 1628, he signed the Petition of Rights and promised that he wouldn't raise taxes without Parliament's consent. However, he ignores that order and raises taxes anyway. And he continues to ignore Parliament for the next 11 years. And this will lead to one of the causes of the English Civil War in 1642. When the war broke out, the two sides were Charles the Catholics were known as the Cavaliers, and they were loyal to the crown, and you had the Roundheads, who were loyal to Parliament and the Protestants. And they fought for about 4 years, and ultimately, Charles and the crown lost, and Charles was put on trial for treason. Charles was executed in 1649, marking one of the first times that a monarchy had been overthrown by the will of the people. While England is in the midst of its civil war and a power struggle between Parliament and the king, in France, power is consolidated under the reign of Louis XIV, the Sun King. Louis calls himself the Sun King because he's the source of light for all of his people. And we know that the sun is the center of the solar system. Well, the king would be the center of power for the people of France. During Louis' 72-year reign, he strips nobles of their power and increases the power of the monarchy. He sets the standard for European culture of the 15th century and begins the construction of the Palace of Versailles, which will also become known as a symbol of French power. During his tenure, he doesn't convene the Estates General, which is France's Congress, so there's no real check on the king's authority. During his 72-year tenure from 1667 to 1713, France fights 4 wars and runs up staggering deficits. By the end of Louis XIV's tenure, when he dies in 1715, France faced enormous debts and a legion of enemies. While Louis XIV is consolidating power in France, the monarchy is restored in England under the rule of Charles II. Unlike his father, Charles II governs differently. For example, Charles suspends law that Parliament had passed earlier that discriminated against Catholics, and Parliament in turn said that only Anglicans could hold military and civil offices, so more religious and political disagreements followed. As a result, we get the development of political parties in England. We have Tories that are loyal to the crown, and we have the Whigs that are loyal to Parliament. Before his death, Charles II converts to Catholicism, leaving his brother, James II, to follow in his reign. However, James II was also Catholic and had tremendous problems with Parliament. Many in England feel that because James II was about to convert to Catholicism, he would also make England a Catholic country. So Parliament forces James II into exile and calls on James II's son-in-law and daughter, William III of Orange and Mary II, to become King and Queen of England. This is known as the Glorious Revolution in 1668, and it's a glorious revolution because it's a peaceful transfer of power. The English Civil War was still on the minds of many Englanders, and Parliament forced William and Mary to sign the English Bill of Rights. This brought tremendous limitations to the King and Queen's power. For example, kings and queens could no longer suspend Parliament, they could no longer tax without Parliament's consent, they could no longer offer cruel and unusual punishment to foes of the crown, and free speech was granted for members of Parliament to criticize the crown. It said the monarchy could raise an army only with Parliament's consent and help create a system of government that was based on the idea of a limited monarchy. Following the death of Mary in 1694, England sustained a period of about 65 years where the crown ruled jointly with Parliament. Trouble begins in 1763 when King George goes to war with France for control of the North American continent. France and Great Britain compete for territory in North America, and war breaks out with the Indians making an alliance with the French against the American colonists. Great Britain goes on to defeat the French and the Indians, and as a result, they lay claim to new lands west of the Appalachian Mountains. Unfortunately, the cost of the war forces the king to raise taxes on the colonists, and many colonists are displeased with the number of taxes that they now have to pay in order to support the king's army in North America. Angered over the increase in taxes the colonists now have to pay, the lack of representation in Parliament, and the quartering of soldiers beginning in the 1700s, the American colonists in 1775 open an armed rebellion against the king's army in the colonies.
And liberty will reign in America.
The Second Continental Congress debated what to do. And in the spring of 1776, Virginia introduced a resolution for independence from Great Britain. After heated debate on July 2, 1776, the measure was voted on and adopted on July 4, 1776, and the colonists declared their independence from Great Britain. Thomas Jefferson wrote in the Declaration of Independence that it was the right of the people to overthrow the government if the government did not take care of them. It gave people the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, what Jefferson called inalienable rights. After years of frustration and setbacks, the Americans make an alliance with France and go on to defeat the British in 1783. Following its victory over Great Britain, the United States of America in 1783 forms a new type of government. This is known as a constitutional republic, or a representative democracy. Within this new federal republic, power is divided amongst three branches of government. There's a legislative branch to make laws, an executive branch to enforce laws, and an independent judiciary to interpret laws. Additionally, there's a Bill of Rights, which guarantees citizens free speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, the ability of due process, and safeguards against governmental abuses of power. Rights for women, African Americans, and Native Americans were not secured, but the United States of America had begun. Like the Americans, the French wanted to overthrow their royal government. They were tired of years of mismanagement of the finances and the injustice of the class system in France. France, like England, had to repay war debt, and to figure it all out, in May of 1789, the French king, Louis XVI, called a meeting of the Estates General, which included representatives from the three estates. The king, unfortunately, was not able to win over support for his financial reforms, and in July of 1789, a revolution broke out. The revolution in France would consume the French people and the French government, and ultimately end with the death of the monarchy and the birth of republicanism in France. As the 18th century wore on, people increasingly protested against governments that failed to recognize individual and natural rights. All over Europe and in its colonies, revolution and reaction were in the air in the late 18th century.